Coming up on this edition of the FGCU Sports Report, we look at some student athletes who excel in the classroom as well as the ball field. We serve up a look inside the men's tennis program, and we sit down with women's tennis head coach Jennifer Gabou to find out the secret to her team's fast start. All that and more on this week's FGCU Sports Report.
The FGCU Sports Report is made possible by Fort Myers Toyota on the big corner of Colonial and Fowler, proud sponsor of FGCU Athletics and WGCU Public Broadcasting, and Mutual of Omaha Bank, matching the right financial service to the right customer at the right time. Mutual of Omaha Bank, your bank every step of the way. And the Eagles Club, FGCU Athletics Boosters Club, committed to providing the finest academic and athletic opportunities to FGCU athletes. Online at FGCUathletics.com. And Dr. John C. Kagan, treating joint pain, sports medicine, and general orthopedics for more than 30 years and proud to support FGCU Athletics.
Hello, Eagles fans. I'm your host, Tom James, and welcome to another edition of the FGCU Sports Report. It's often said that tennis is a sport for a lifetime. It improves balance and coordination. You have fun with friends, and of course, it's a great workout. And as Rochelle Grossman reports, tennis is a sport that also teaches lessons beyond the court.
A rare rainy Florida afternoon forces Eagle tennis masters Mitch Lavosky and freshman Dean Thomas into the weight room for training.
You have to be strong, but it's a different kind of strong. You don't have to be like huge muscles and everything. It's more core strength and stuff like that.
Time in the gym prepares Dean for the intensity of game day action. With practice 6 days and 20 hours a week, the rivalries are fierce.
The competition difference between high school and college is such a big jump. I mean, this is one step below pro, I guess you can look at it. I mean, these guys are all here for a reason.
Hailing from Northern Kentucky, Dean is learning to balance life as a college athlete, finding time to enjoy the experience while playing the game.
I love it. It's awesome. I mean, we have a beach on campus. You can't compare it to Kentucky. It's awesome. The weather's incredible. I mean, it's tough balancing everything out. I mean, you got practice every single day, pretty much, and you got classes and homework you got to fit into your schedule after that. There's not a whole lot of time to do much else besides school and tennis.
Mitch also knows the routine well. As a senior, he's learned the key to enduring 5.5 hour matches begins off the court. You have to be mentally and physically strong to compete.
You know, I think it's like a chess game. You always have to think. You always have to think about the next step. And it's a great sport that will keep you in shape and keep you motivated to go out there and be in the best shape of your life. You're always thinking about the next move, or the next thing that's going to happen to you. So in tennis, a shot that you hit right now is going to affect the next ball is going to come back to you. So you're always thinking about the future, and you're always thinking strategically and also tactically when you play tennis.
Men's tennis coach and also FGCU assistant athletic director Jay Webb Horton agrees. Lessons learned on the court translate to real life.
Well, tennis is a sport of a lifetime. I mean, you know, I'm 64 years old. I still play this sport competitively. I mean, we have 12 outstanding tennis courts here in Southwest Florida. We have some of the best tennis players in the country playing in Florida right now.
Both Mitch and Dean are among that prized list, and coach says they're true competitors.
Dean's a competitor, he's a grinder, doesn't quit. Just the kind of people I like are warriors, and Dean's a warrior. Really steady, and I think he's a freshman this year. I think at the end of his career, he's gonna be one of our best ever. Mitchell's a transfer student, very steady, tough competitor. I mean, all the things we like. We want people to get out and get at it. And Mitchell sort of embodies that. I mean, he's a fighter.
Mitch's goals go beyond college. Already the CEO of his own business, his tennis career took an unexpected turn. Mitch moved to Florida at 15, stopped full-time schooling to leave more time for practice, only to have a crushing back injury derail his plans.
I knew that I was, you know, a good player at the time, but I wanted to see how I can fulfill my potential, reach my potential, and so I did online schooling. I played about 6 hours a day, about 3 hours in the morning. Would have 2 hours for lunch or so. I would, you know, eat for 30 minutes and then do some homework in between. And then in the afternoon, play for another 2-3 hours and then, you know, rest up and do it all over again the next day.
The injury put a fast halt to his routine. But the downtime left Mitch cultivating Plan B. He developed his own brand of tennis strings and accessories.
Started off, you know, with my inventory in a closet, and now I've grown to a, you know, 2,000-foot, you know, warehouse, and having sales reps and distributors all over the country and world.
Future plans also call for grad school and growing the business. Dean, meantime, has got years of college tennis to look forward to. Beyond that, his goals don't stray far from the court.
I want to be a coach. I want to coach a college team. That's my biggest goal for sure.
A dream any tennis coach would be proud of.
I mean, you got to be prepared. You got to work hard. And then you have to have a sense of integrity to compete. You know, other players may cheat. You must be above that. So in life, if you're going in the job, you work hard. And then your word is your bond. And what we try to do with our athletes, whether it's tennis or basketball, any of the sports, we want to teach them that A, hard work, preparation, doesn't always mean you're going to be successful, but you're in a better place than you would be if you weren't.
For the FGCU Sports Report, I'm Rochelle Grossman.
Thanks, Rochelle. We've got a lot of Eagle highlights from this past week, so let's get busy. On February the 24th, the women's basketball team hosted Jacksonville right here at Alico Arena, looking to clinch at least a share of the Atlantic Sun regular season crown with a win. The Dolphins, however, were not about to lay down, trading leads and keeping the game close throughout the night. But the Lady Eagles never faltered, and a big run late in the game gave the blue and green enough of a cushion as they were able to hold on for a 64-59 victory. FGCU clinches its second A-Sun Conference crown and their fourth consecutive WNIT bid. Congratulations to the FGCU women's basketball team. And there was no let up on Saturday the 26th as the women's team looked sharp, taking on North Florida at Alico Arena. Five Eagles scored in double figures as they buried the Ospreys 70-54. With the win, the blue and green extend their home winning streak to 38 games. It's the third longest streak in the nation behind UConn and Stanford. And on the 28th, the Lady Eagles wrapped up their conference schedule with a makeup game against USC Upstate in Spartanburg. And the Lady Eagles, who have lived by the three all season, got a taste of their own medicine in this game as Upstate's Chelsea McMillan drains a triple with 4 seconds on the clock to give USC Upstate the upset victory over the blue and green. The men's basketball team was in action against Jacksonville on February the 24th at Alico Arena, and it was a dandy. With only 9 seconds left in the game, a Jacksonville basket gave the Dolphins a 55-53 lead and an apparent victory. But the Eagles had one more chance, and with 2 seconds left on the clock, freshman Christoph Varadell drains a three-pointer to give the Eagles a thrilling 56-55 conference victory. Unfortunately, the Eagles couldn't repeat their last-minute magic against conference foe North Florida on the 26th. In a tightly matched contest, it came down to the visiting Ospreys holding a 53-51 lead with 15 seconds left on the clock. The Eagles once again had a chance at the end, but this time, Varadell's game-tying jumper from the baseline hit the back of the rim and bounced out, giving UNF the victory. And on February the 28th, the men also went to Spartanburg for their makeup game against USC Upstate. And led by a career-high 26 points from sophomore Sherwood Brown and a Division I school record 14 threes, the Eagles wrapped up their A-Sun season in style with an 81-65 win over the Spartans. The Eagles softball team hosted the Moe's Blue and Green Invite February the 26th through the 27th and came up a couple of tacos short of a full plate. In the Friday opener, FGCU lost to Iowa 11-9 in a real hitter's duel. And then on Saturday, the Lady Eagles couldn't put many runs across the plate in a 7-1 loss to the Salukis of Southern Illinois. The blue and green bounced back on Sunday, however, taking down Albany by a score of 2-1 And in the afternoon game, the Eagles put the run rule on St. Francis with a score of 12-0 in five innings. With the two wins on Sunday, the Lady Eagles improved to 5-9 on the season. The Eagle baseball team hosted the Big Ten's Fighting Illini for a three-game series last weekend, and Illinois was apparently in a fighting mood as they beat the Eagles 6-3 on Friday night, followed by a 7-2 drubbing on Saturday. The Eagles came back on Sunday, though, with a sparkling 5-1 victory behind the fine pitching of senior Richie Erath. With the win, the Eagles improved to 3-4 on the season. The women's tennis team traveled to DeLand on February the 26th to take on the Stetson Hatters for the Eagles conference opener. But the Eagles got their hats handed to them in this one as Stetson dominated the matches en route to a 6-1 victory. Sophomore Morgan Bechtel picked up the lone singles victory for the Eagles. The men's tennis team was also in DeLand on the 26th to play Stetson for the Eagles conference opener. And unfortunately, the men's team fared no better as they failed to win a match and were swept by the Hatters 7-0. The next day, the men's team was in Orlando to wield their rackets on the court of the Central Florida Knights. The Eagles were willing but not able, however, as UCF made a clean sweep of the contest, slaying the Eagles 7-0. And to get the latest news, scores, and highlights for all of FGCU sports, log on to FGCUathletics.com, the official site of the FGCU Eagles. For this week's first player profile, we shine the Sports Report spotlight on women's basketball standout Siobhan Butler. Take a look.
I chose to come to FGCU because when I was a freshman in college, at my junior college, my coach used to play for him, and she told me about how awesome he was and how he ran a good game and how he was just a great coach and that I'd benefit playing for him. So I chose to come here because of her. The best coaching advice I got was to play my game and be confident and be strong. I came in last semester not really knowing how I would fit and help the team out, but with the coaching and him working with me, I've been able to, you know, help out and just play my game. I love Steve Nash. His all-around game is just amazing. He's unselfish with the ball. He has awareness on the court, and he's just a great player, also defensively. So far, my best memory here has been playing against Indiana and how we beat them, and also our first game against Seton Hall, how I was able to provide the last winning baskets with free throws. After FGCU, I plan on becoming a criminal justice, like a police officer. You know, use my degree that I got from here to, you know, start my career and just start life.
Jennifer Gabou, women's tennis coach here at FGCU, joining us on the Sports Report. Your first time on the show. Welcome.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Hey, your third season just underway as a head coach of FGCU. You have seven players, and right. Six of them are freshmen or sophomore. That's about as young as you can get, isn't it?
That's right, Tom. It's a very young team, and I'm very excited to see how they'll improve over this season and also into the future.
Diverse roster, too. You
yes.
have players from four different countries, the U.S., Portugal, South Africa, and Canada. How does such a diverse group find its way to FGCU?
Well, I probably get, 100 emails a week from international student athletes, prospective athletes, and you pile through those and you look over all of the rosters and their accomplishments, and you really choose. And I'm fortunate that for example, Bettina Botha, never met her in person. She came into the airport from South Africa, and I'm fortunate she's a wonderful young lady. First time ever meeting her.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. You're the third coach in FGCU women's tennis
history.
Yeah. And you led the Eagles to their first winning season, and now you've kind of made them an A-Sun contender for the first time. How'd you do it?
Well, I have to say, I'm really fortunate. I have a great group, but the four characteristics of our team I always focus on are student, athlete, ambassador, and teammate. So we focus on those principles by doing a lot of community service work and also achieving high goals in the classroom. And so I'm really proud of them. That's how we get it done.
I wanted to ask you about the community service, because that's a big part of FGCU tennis. And you had a goal, I think, in 2010 to do 400 hours of community service, and you reached that goal.
Yes.
Why is that so important to you?
Well, I'm very competitive, and I have to say we have a win over the Florida football team. They're about 8 times larger than us, and they did 300 community service hours last year. So take that, Florida.
There you go.
But just really, I think it's wonderful to give them a perspective when they get into the community. And I think that it helps build success within them. So in 2 years, we've done over 700 community service hours.
Wow, yeah. Congratulations.
Thank you.
That's
thank you.
Great to be such a part of the community in Southwest Florida. Now, you mentioned the University of Florida.
Right.
That's where you played your college tennis.
That's my alma mater.
You're a Gator, Orange and Blue, and you were a standout. You played number one in Division I singles. You also led the Gators to the national championship back in 03. I mean, with that kind of a track record, for you as a player, how do you manage the expectations of your current players when they see your resume? Maybe their goals are pretty lofty. How do you kind of manage their expectations of themselves?
Right. Well, I always tell them, if you want to be number one in the nation, I can get you there. I have never been number one in the world, but I'm coaching Division I tennis, so we're pretty fortunate. And I think it's wonderful because it shows them, you know, you can go to an academy, you can come from the Midwest, I'm originally from Kansas, and you can still make it to the top. Mm-hmm. And what's really unique is when you win the national championship, you get to meet the president. So we've got our eye on the prize next couple years here.
Wow, that must have been neat.
What
was the White House like?
Absolutely white.
As white as you can get.
That's right.
You trained as a junior at the famous Bolotary Academy. You played junior tennis, and I mean, you went all over the globe. What was that experience like?
Tremendous honor. Tremendous honor. I was on Team USA as a junior, the junior Team USA. I was fortunate to go to over 20 different countries for free, actually, and had amazing coaches. Nick Bolotary, Stan Smith was on the China tour, and it's just an honor, a total honor.
Yeah, 20 different countries before you even turned pro.
Before I even went to University of Florida.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. You were pro for a period of time.
Briefly.
What was that experience like?
You know, it was amazing. I was prepared for everything on the tour except for the lifestyle.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, so it was always challenging, but it's really neat to go out there and see some amazing players, see some of my former teammates who are now coaches in Division I as well. So it's an awesome, awesome experience. You've got to really have the eye of the tiger out there.
What are your hopes for the team for the rest of this year? You've just kind of begun conference play.
Right.
You got off to a great start. What do you see out there for 2011?
Well, you know, I know that our main goal is to be in the top of the conference. We were preseason ranked number 4, and so we want to finish inside of that. And I'm always telling my girls, you know what? You went out there, you did well, but could you have done better? Mm-hmm. So if you can win the match, I want them to dominate.
Southwest Florida, by the way, is a big tennis area.
It is.
Is it hard for you easy for you to get interest from the locals in FGCU tennis? Is that something you shoot for?
Well, we're really fortunate because we do a lot of community work. We're trying to add value to the university. And so what's been unique is the community sees that and they're responding and they come out and just really thankful. Now that we have a shade structure, it's a lot easier to watch the matches.
That makes it a lot easier.
Yes, it is.
All right, Jennifer Gabou, women's tennis coach at FGCU.
Thanks for coming by. Thanks for having me, Tom.
All right.
And just a reminder, you can always friend the Sports Report on Facebook and tweet us on Twitter. And watch the Sports Report 24/7 on YouTube. Just log on to the addresses on your screen and enjoy. Player of the game, player of the week, most valuable player. All awards given to athletes for their on-field accomplishments. Sports reporter Katie Kaufman, however, attended a recent luncheon where FGCU student athletes were presented with a different type of award. Here's her story.
Student athletes are often recognized for their accomplishments in uniform. However, FGCU student athletes have combined for a cumulative 3.15 GPA, exceeding the 2.97 GPA of the university's general student body. The FGCU Athletics Department held their second annual luncheon to recognize their above and beyond efforts in the classroom.
The event today, it's our second annual Academic Honors Luncheon where we honor the student athletes who've earned a cumulative 3.5 GPA or higher and have been here for at least two full semesters. So we had just under 50 student athletes who were honored at this event today.
Junior Gina Petracco is a member of the soccer team. Along with helping her team earn the title of Atlantic Sun Conference Champions, she maintains a perfect cumulative 4.0 GPA.
Feels really good. It's nice to be, you know, have a good GPA and be able to balance sports and your schoolwork. School is a priority to me. You know, once soccer is over, you know, school is all you have. So, you know, time management and time for yourself and being able to balance school and soccer is the biggest thing.
Junior swimmer Terry Lytle has also earned an unblemished 4.0 GPA. She gave a heartfelt speech about her experiences managing being a student and an athlete.
Just remember that even though we may be three times as busy as everyone else, we are experiencing three times as much. It's something that I wouldn't trade for anything, and I hope you feel the same.
You have a 4.0 GPA. How do you balance being a student athlete and keeping such a perfect GPA?
It's a balance between school and sport. I try my hardest in the classroom because I want to find what I'm good at, so I give my best effort in the classroom, and I go to help with for professors when I need it. I have a great group of friends that I study with and do homework with, and Neil's always pushing me in the pool to do my best and to keep going forward.
Is a sophomore social work major.
University President Wilson Bradshaw attended the luncheon and presented each student athlete with a gift honoring his or her accomplishments. Along with Dr. Bradshaw, Athletics Director Ken Cavanaugh was in attendance to show his support.
When they're a student and an athlete, it's supposed to be 50-50, and so often most of the accolades come around their athletic achievements, which we not only desire, we're very happy to do so. But to me, this is one of the most special days as an athletic director or administrator to be around this great group and to be able to celebrate their accomplishments collectively and as a whole.
Thanks, Katie. And as always, you can find the latest news and information for all of FGCU sports at FGCUathletics.com, the official site of the FGCU Eagles. For our second player profile this week, we put the questions to Eagles swimming standout Taylor Cook.
I chose FGCU because it's by the beach and it's a great campus with good dorms, and swimming coach was awesome, and it was just like an opportunity to start a new program. I dueled in cross country and swimming because my ultimate love is triathlons, and after some season ends in a couple weeks, I'm gonna really focus on them and try to go pro and race with the fast girls. I balanced two sports by just like working with the coaches. Both coaches the last like 3 years have been really helpful, helping me like, you know, be able to miss a practice or a meet here or there. Swimming would probably be my favorite sport right now, but triathlons in general, and then swimming. Got a great coach, parents are always supportive, and I've had a really great roommate system at G6, so. I'm definitely the very fun, energetic one. 6 a.m. practice, everybody's tired, but I'll be the one cheering and waking everybody up. I already started grad school at FGCU, so I've got 2 more years here, and then after that, I'll probably get a job either somewhere in the local area as a physical therapist.
Now let's take a look at what's coming up on the FGCU sports schedule for next week. On March the 8th, the Eagles baseball team travels up to Tampa to take on the University of South Florida. That game starts at 7 p.m. And then beginning on March the 11th, the baseball team travels to Macon, Georgia for a three-game stand with the Mercer Bears in a key conference series. The Eagles softball team will be heading west next week to beautiful Tempe, Arizona for some softball action. On March the 9th, the Lady Eagles will take on 10th-ranked Arizona State. And then from March 10th through the 12th, the team will extend their Tempe visit to take part in the Arizona State Diamond Devil Tournament. On March the 7th, beginning at 1 p.m., the men's tennis team will take on Southern Illinois Edwardsville right here at the FGCU Tennis Complex. The women's tennis team will also be in action on the 7th, taking on Toledo here at the FGCU Tennis Complex. The ladies' matches are scheduled for a 2:30 p.m. start. After that, the men's and women's teams will be hitting the highway for a road trip together, stopping first in Statesboro, Georgia on March the 9th, where both the men and women will take on the Georgia Southern teams, followed by a trip to Kennesaw to take on the Kennesaw State Owls. And on the 12th, the Eagles will make a stop in Macon to trade serves with the Mercer Bears in another conference matchup. And on March 10th, the women's golf team tees it up at Eagle Landing Golf Club in Jacksonville, Florida for the James Madison Invitational. And as always, we wish the Eagles the best of luck. Well, it's game, set, and match for this edition of the FGCU Sports Report. But we'll be back this time next week to bring you all of the Eagles sporting news and highlights. I'm Tom James. Thanks for watching, and go Eagles.